Hello and welcome, I'm Barkha Dutt, and today a Mojo exclusive. The Supreme Court has stepped in and permitted the daughter of former Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir, Mehbooba Mufti, Iltija, to travel to Srinagar and meet her mother. It's been exactly 30 days, that's 1 month, since mainstream leaders were detained. Omar and Mehbooba Mufti spent their time in detention in solitary confinement for the most part. In the last few days, their relatives are being permitted to meet them, and the Supreme Court today gave that permission to her daughter. Iltija Mufti will be travelling from Chennai to Srinagar to meet her mother for the first time in a month. She spoke to me in this in-depth interview on what the future of mainstream parties looks like, what she feels as a young Kashmiri, and her pleas to the government to reveal a blueprint, a roadmap for the future.
Iltija, let me start by asking you, it must come as some relief that you're finally going to be able to see your mother. How many days has it been since you've had zero contact with her?
It's been a month today. My mother was taken on the 5th, and I think today is the 4th, or is it the 5th?
It's the 5th.
It's the 5th. So it's been exactly a month. She was taken a month ago, and Barkha, Eid has come and gone, and you know, I've had no contact with her, and it feels surreal in a very bad way, you know, to know that my mother has been put in jail, and I don't even know the exact reason. So I feel a huge sense of relief, but I'm also concerned about the situation in Kashmir. Everybody is not a politician's daughter that they'll be given that airtime to, you know, talk about their grievances and the way they're being suppressed and the way they're suffering.
And what is the first thing you'd like to say to your mother when you meet her? What's the first thing you'd like to do?
That is an entirely private conversation. I think, you know, the fact that she's been so strong through this whole solitary confinement ordeal, you know, I'm sure it's been hard for her. So, you know, between mother and daughter, I just wanted to know that we you know, we love her a lot, and, you know, I've missed her, and I just wanted to know that everything is going to be fine. And it's something that I would say to every Kashmiri as well. I think Kashmiris are in a lot of pain right now, Barkha, and it's just not my mother. You know, the valley is in so much pain right now that everybody needs to reach out to each other.
Can I ask you to tell us a little bit about how she's doing? And the reason I ask this is because I know in the last few days only, after extended solitary confinement, as you mentioned, your aunt Rubaya was able to meet with her. What is the news on her? Well, how has she been passing her time? Because solitary confinement is especially obviously difficult.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I think they had no plans of letting her meet the family. They didn't. I'm not sure if they wanted to facilitate it, Barkha, because you can pull out CCTV footage from my gate. There was not a day that passed when I didn't tell them that I want to meet her. But from what I hear, she's doing all right. I mean, she can do, you know, she's as good as somebody who's been in solitary confinement for a month. She's allowed to take books. You know, I sent her lots of books with great difficulty, and I'm glad that at least she'll start reading. That's the only good thing about this that I see. I mean, I'm taking it, it's dark humor in such a tough time. But, you know, she'll be reading more. But I think every Kashmiri is suffering, Barkha. It's just not about my mother. Every Kashmiri right now is caged. You know, contrary to whatever reports that are coming out from the center and the kind of narrative that they want to, people to believe, it's not like that at all. I think Kashmiris are suffering and there is a lot of pain right now.
Iltija, I'm going to talk to you in a moment about the larger picture, about the Kashmir Valley and the state, and now a union territory, I should correct myself. I do want to, though, ask you, what books have you sent her? I know you're saying dark humor is your way of coping. What does she, you know, what is the message she probably sent for you through your aunt Rubaya? What are the books you're sending? How have you tried to keep her morale up?
Barkha, the government claims that they've restored landlines, but they haven't, because the landlines in Gupkar and Crescent Lake are still not working. So I've had no contact with my aunt and grandmother. I still don't know how my mother is doing. And it's been, I think, over a week since they met her for the first time. But my mother's a very strong woman, and she's not the kind of person who's going to be, you know, pushed around or be demoralized. And she has a lot of inner strength, and I have full faith in her, you know.
Let me ask you. Media reports suggested that initially the two former chief ministers, apart from Farooq Abdullah, who's under house arrest, Omar Abdullah and your mother were actually lodged in the same place. And then you had this report coming out in Times mm-hmm. of India that suggested that they'd actually had a fight, mm-hmm. that they were blaming each other for the situation today, and that's why they were separated. What can you say? Because you must have apart from Farooq Abdullah, who's under
media that are given free rides in helicopters and that are being given free Wi-Fi, and they're able to, they paint the picture that the authorities want them to, you know, to put in front of other people. So can you really trust the kind of stories that emanate from them? It's cheap tabloid sensationalism. I mean, can you imagine former chief ministers fighting, arguing? It's complete patent nonsense. I know for a fact that they were separated because the authorities in Kashmir were very paranoid that they would end up talking to each other, and basically they just want both of them, they want both Omar Saab and my mother to be in solitary confinement so that at some point, you know, they feel the pinch and they feel that pressure. And that's why I approached the court, because I think it's unfair. Even hardened criminals have, you know, the right to meet their relatives and their loved ones. So why should my mother, or why should any political detainee be deprived of that right? That's ridiculous.
Before they were detained, there was the Gupta resolution that a number of the mainstream parties had come together. Your mother was, in fact, leading that initiative, I remember. And do you believe now, as someone who's observed the politics of Kashmir for a long time, that once they're out, the mainstream is going to have to unite, that it is, in a sense, an existential crisis?
Barkha, I think all journalists are asking this question. They're asking the wrong question. You need to ask, is India in crisis? Is the idea of India in crisis? You know, Kashmir acceded to a secular and a democratic India. I mean, forget what's happened in Kashmir. Look what's happened in Assam. You know, 17 lakh people have been rendered stateless. I think the question that we really need to ask is this the country we believe in? Is this the country we stand for? It's just not about mainstream parties in Kashmir. Aapko kya milega unko discredit karke? In Kashmir is a part of India. If your own people feel resentment towards you, isn't that a set role of thought, Barkha?
One of the reasons, every time on my trips when I try to ask the administration and, you know, and even the center here, what is being achieved by, imprisoning those who have stood with the idea of India, right? I've asked this question repeatedly. Mm-hmm. And one of the arguments that they make is that, they really needed to learn from the mistakes that were made when Burhan Wani was eliminated, that their priority was mm-hmm. to save lives, and that some of these leaders could have done rabble-rousing by sort of leading crowds on the streets. And they point in particular to your mother's tweet, which called India, which said that after 370 was gone, this was now like an occupational force. When you look back at that tweet, do you believe that she should have said that? And what do you make of this larger argument by the administration that repeatedly says our priority is that lives should not be lost and law and order should be maintained?
Barkha, are we living in North Korea or is this India? I'm just asking, is this the world's largest democracy or are we living under dictatorship? Is it a dictatorial regime? I mean, can people not express themselves? You are saying that you detain these leaders, then you run that narrative, Muftis, Abdullahs, you know, they ruined Kashmir, we finished them, people are very happy. On the other, you know, their approach is riddled with contradictions. Can a tweet be justified for the reason why she's been detained? Are you telling me she's been justified because of a tweet? And by the way, in that tweet, nowhere does she write that, you know, people, you know, start assembling, go on the streets, we want bloodshed. No, she said that, you know, please maintain a sense of peace, maintain a sense of calm, and everything will be fine. How have you treated these leaders, Barkha? These are the same leaders that swore oath, to the Constitution of India. What have you achieved by demoralizing them? Leaders are not created in a year, 2 months, inko lag raha hai, they'll create lower rung leaders and all. That's not how leaders are created. You can't all of a sudden discredit, politicians, former chief ministers in this manner. Please look at the way in which they've treated Farooq Saab. My family and me, we watched the first interview that went out in which he broke down. I felt terribly upset. That man is my grandfather's age. How is he being treated? It's appalling.
Talking about grandfathers, if Mufti Saab were alive today, you know, and I still remember, before he did the alliance with the BJP, he was an optimist and he told me, he said, I know it's like the North Pole and the South Pole coming together, but I have to do it for the sake of the state. How would he have looked at the developments today?
I think, you know, he would have felt betrayed. And I think every Kashmiri today feels a sense of shock. They feel a sense of betrayal. And I'm just glad that he's not around because, you know, people are still not able to process what's happened. You know, the state is not only have you abrogated Article 370, you've demoted the state and you're saying that we don't want people to react and you're going to gag them. I'm trying to understand what the government's plan is. Surely their plan wasn't just to put a curfew forever, right? Like, there has to be some plan. I'm concerned they don't have a blueprint. I'm concerned that they haven't thought this through and now they don't know what's next.
How do you respond to some of the, you know, the counter arguments, that this great domestic opinion that has backed the abrogation, that it has been a political masterstroke? You must have seen this kind of commentary, right? In a lot of the media, even a lot of opposition parties, including the Congress, for example, have spoken in two voices. Some of the smaller parties actually supported Mr. Modi. There were other parties like Srinagar that walked out and didn't take a position on the vote.
Yeah.
So how do you respond to the counter argument that the mainstream parties were not able to contribute to the development of the state and it was time for a new template, a new formula, for something new to be experimented with?
Barkha, I think India right now is witnessing a kind of like toxic, muscular hyper-nationalism that doesn't, you know, celebrate diversity. And people who are celebrating this, they clearly don't have a good understanding about the issue of Jammu and Kashmir. They've given that development argument. If you look at development parameters, Kashmir is way ahead of even states like Gujarat. So, you know, to create that whole thing, ki isse ye nahi ho raha tha, isse wo nahi ho raha tha, and please tell me one thing. You have a government that has a brute majority that's just broken up a state. It's kind of a partition, right? Like, they've massacred this state. They've seized it into two parts. Are you telling me that there's a guarantee that this is not going to happen to any state tomorrow, Barkha? It set a very wrong precedent. You know, our country thrives on the federalism model. They've tried to attack that model of federalism, you know, that gives states power. Mm-hmm. And as far as other people are concerned, like, you know, what can I say? There's so much of misconception. Please tell me, BJP has regional allies that have the dynasties, right? And they're run by families, right? Like, I don't even need to tell you, Bombay, Punjab, look at all these states. So tomorrow, if you accuse them of misgovernance, so aap kya unko jail mein daal denge? And then you say, yahan jo bhi hua hai, inki wajah se hua hai. But we all know Kashmir has been a major problem and there's lots of players that have contributed to the mess. It's also the government of India, BJP, whether it's BJP or even Congress, everybody has had a role to play. You cannot just isolate the mainstream people who picked up the flag of India when Kashmiri people had nothing but contempt for India and take a stick and be like, you know what, they're going to be our fall guy. They're going to be our scapegoats. No, I'm sorry. You need to accept that nobody can be absolved of their responsibility. Everybody has sadly played a role in this crisis, Barkha. You can't all of a sudden make my mother, Omar Saab, the scapegoat. And by the way, TDP has been in power for a total of 5 years. I've said this in a previous interview as well. But they have such a strong mechanism, propaganda that's backed by media that they keep putting this out. Muftis, Abdullah, Barkha, please tell me how wrong was my grandfather the chief minister for? How long was Mehbooba Mufti the chief minister for? For how long will you keep pulling wool over the eyes of people? And yes, you said opposition people are scared. They are scared because they'll be berated as anti-national. You say anything against government, it's taken as anti-India. I'm sorry if I criticize the government for a move. How can I be anti-India, Barkha? I feel like it threatens the idea of India. So I'm speaking up, but unfortunately they have this troll army that's unleashed. They did the same thing with Rahul Gandhi when he spoke up, you know, and then Pakistan cited him in some resolution of theirs and then they got on their case. But I'm sorry, why are you so obsessed with Pakistan? India has suspended civil liberties for 8 million people. The state has been grappling for the past month. Barkha, what does Pakistan have to do about this? And then if we speak up, what, they're anti-national? Why are they anti-national?
What, you know, you brought up Pakistan and say, why bring Pakistan into every conversation? Of course, the counter will be that Pakistan has long fomented militancy, long sponsored groups like the Lashkar and the Jaish, and therefore Pakistan's role in even Imran Khan's meltdowns in the last 1 month cannot be ignored.
Now, what I'm saying is that Kashmir is a part of India. It's not a part of Pakistan. India is responsible. The country is responsible for whatever is happening in Kashmir. why are you giving Kashmiris a reason to feel validated, Barkha? They're celebrating ki mainstream khatam ho gayi hai. Aap kya kar rahe hai? You're celebrating. People are happy because they feel that they feel vindicated, you know. They feel like, oh, you know, we used to fight for Pakistan and these leaders, they said, you know, no, we believe in.
So you're saying it strengthened the secessionists. Basically, what's happening is strengthening the secessionists and weakening the mainstream.
Indian people, Barkha, even Indian masses have sadly shown no empathy. I am on Twitter, I see all these comments that people say, oh, so kya hua aapka internet gaya? You know, growth aa rahi hai, development aa rahi hai. Are wo bechara daily wages jo din ka 500 kamata hai, wo kya karega, wo bachcho ko kya khilayega, Barkha? Ek mahine se wo kaam pe nahi gaya. Aap future ki kya baat kar rahe hain, aap present dekh lijiye. And I request the government of India, you please come up with a proper plan. How are you going to win over the trust of the people? If this is just about land that you know, the land is yours now, jo karna tha aapne kar liya. But logon ko agar resentment rahegi, agar ye kehte hain ki ye development ke liye kiya gaya hai, then you're defeating the purpose, right? Because how will there be any development? Isn't peace a prerequisite for development of any kind, Barkha?
Let me ask you in the end, certain officials told me and have told other reporters as well that there's some outreach that they've tried with all these mainstream politicians, and there's a suggestion that they want some sort of commitment. They don't share what, but they want some sort of commitment, some sort of terms and conditions on which these leaders will be detained. Have you heard anything about this?
पहले गलती क्या है कि आप इन पे वो conditions लगाएंगे? This is a democracy, for God's sake. You cannot trample on our core democratic values and say ki we'll release them if they say. I don't know what's happening, honestly. I haven't met my mother. I am not in touch with anybody from the government. But please respect the fact that India is the world's largest democracy. What kind of a signal are you giving to the world if you're saying that, you know, we've detained these people for no reason, for no fault of theirs. They've been with us for over a month, but we'll only release them on certain conditions.